Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Once more, Ashoura is upon us. It's in a couple days and we are getting ready for those who are looking for the reward. A whole year of expiation from our sins. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said that when he asked about as to why the Jews fasted Ashura, they said this is a day Musa alayhi salam, Moshe, had fasted it. Rasulullah said something extremely interesting. He says we are more entitled to Musa than the Jews themselves. And by that, we are more entitled to fasting Ashura than the Jews themselves. Subhanallah. What happened exactly on the day of Ashura? Why did Musa alayhi salam fast? And why did the Jews at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam fast? When is Ashura? When does it take place? Is it known? Is it unknown? Do we fast the 9th, the 10th, or the 10th and the 11th, or shall we just fast the 10th by itself? These and so many other questions and so many other inquiries will be dealt with, inshallah, in this talk here, on this super pep talk number 4. My brothers and my sisters, I will say it again one more time. When Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, when Allah legislates and acts in Islam, it don't matter how big the act is, like slaughtering a lamb or just going to Hajj, or as little as it is moving your fingers in a salat. Both big acts, Hajj and moving your fingers, have a connotation, they have a meaning, they have something that pinpoints to the Tawheed. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah alayhi rahmatullah says, in every act of worship, there is a wisdom. Some of us find that wisdom and some of us don't. Those who do will carry the act of worship a lot better than those that copy and paste. Ashura is the 10th day of the sacred month of Muharram. Muharram is one of the 4 months that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared sacred. The Arabs before would fight throughout the year, but in those sacred months, the 4 months, they would not. They used to honor these months greatly. Al-Quran has emphasized the greatness of these months and the evil of the sins that we perform against ourselves or against other people in these months is greatly multiplied. An act of worship in these 4 months is also greatly multiplied. So what makes this month this importance? Why is that? Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives any value to anything He wants. He makes al-Kaaba, which is a bunch of rocks when you look at it, and He calls it the house of Allah and gives it a prestigious status. He also subhanahu wa ta'ala chose a book, a human being, a prophet, a camel, the one that He gave to the prophet Thamud, and so on and so forth. So also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give that to a day like a Friday or Jumu'ah, and a month like Ramadan, a night, Laylatul Qadr, and the 10th of Dhul Hijjah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does what He likes, with what He likes, how He likes, when He wants it. Muharram is a month that holds a special status in Islam. It is the first month in the lunar year, and the first month in our calendar. Just like it is January, Muharram gives an idea, an opening code, so to speak, about what to expect from the year, just as does January. For instance, did you know that January is a god Greek with 2 faces? One face looking forward and one face looking backward. Check it out on the internet. Go there and check out January, and they will present you with a god with 2 faces. In the Greek religion, they believe that January is the only god that can look at the future and is the only god that can look at the previous year. Obviously, to us Muslims, all this is kufr. But that tells you how people used to put a great emphasis on the month or the first month. Muharram. Muharram comes from the term haram, where something is haram in it, and it comes straight away after the month of Dhul Hijjah when people go to the Hajj. Muharram is the month of Allah, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam calls it, like the book of Allah, a great dignifying honor to this month here. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, as in Sahih Muslim, أفضل الصيام بعد رمضان شهر الله المحرم. The most best fasting after the month of Ramadan is the month of Allah, al-Muharram, and this is the month we are in right now. What exactly happened in Ashura? Well, we all think and know that it is the day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa alayhi salam and the children of Israel from Fir'aun. But there is a question here that we need to go back to. Quraysh and the Arabs used to fast it as well in the Jahiliyyah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before migrating to Al-Madinah, he used to fast Ashura in Mecca before Ramadan was made compulsory in year 2. Subhanallah. Oh yes. Quraysh used to fast Ashura, as Ummuna Aisha radiallahu anha says in Sahih Muslim. Inna ahl al-jahiliyyah kanu yasumuna. The people of al-jahiliyyah, the time of ignorance, Quraysh used to fast Ashura, and this is in Sahih Muslim. So what made Quraysh fast Ashura? Well, it helps us to know that in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, and this hadith is authentic, al-Imam Ahmad reported that Nuh alayhi salam's vessel, after the deluge, when the whole thing, the earth, got destroyed, and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala commanded the earth to swallow water, and the heavens to stop the rain, the downfall of the pouring rain, and when the land became safe, and the water dissipates and got swallowed by the earth, the vessel of Nuh alayhi salam found itself parked on a huge mountain called Al-Judi. Al-Judi, we don't know what it is. People say in India this thing, and they are all just assumptions, nothing of it. And it don't matter what where that place is. We don't care, as a matter of fact. It's just on earth. When Nuh alayhi salam came out, he fasted that day. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala brought them back to earth. It didn't happen just like that. That day was Ashura. It was the 10th day of Al-Muharram. Nuh alayhi salam fasted. Between Nuh alayhi salam and Ibrahim alayhi salam, the father of the monotheistic religion, there were only two prophets that were sent, Hud alayhi salam and Saleh, two tribes of the Arabs in Al-Yemen. But right after Nuh alayhi salam, the first big messenger that was sent was Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam honored the 10th day of Ashura and fasted it just like Nuh alayhi salam fasted it. And it became part of the religion of Ibrahim, and the religion of Ibrahim was followed by Quraysh. Yes, they changed it. Yes, they added idols. Yes, they did this shirk and all that kind of stuff. But the roots of that, what they did, was from the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Quraysh fasted Ashura because Ibrahim fasted Ashura, because of Ismail fasted Ashura, because of Nuh alayhi salam fasted Ashura. Now we understand how Ashura made its way to Quraysh and why they fasted it. Now that is Quraysh. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so Quraysh and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasted it before making his migration to Al-Madinah. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Al-Madinah and Ashura came, he was going to fast it like he did before. But there was an element of surprise. He noticed that the Jews also fasted on that day. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, asked, what is this? Why are you fasting on this day? It was an element of surprise. Remember, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Mecca, he did not have any dealings with the Jews. He never had anything with the Jews, either before he became a prophet or after. So for 40 years, he didn't have any dealings with the Jews. When he went to Al-Madinah, he was greatly surprised as to why the Jews were fasting on that day. It is then that he learned, because they told him, that this is a very good day. It's a noble, very respected day. Why is that? Because this is the day Allah saved Musa and the children of Israel from Fir'aun. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam realized that the act of what he was doing now had a root. He understood that that was because of what Allah has done. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, we are more entitled to Musa than you, the children of Israel. Under this expression, and the meaning obviously, نحن أولى به منكم, under this expression we need to put 1,000 lines. Musa is a Jew. He saved the Jewish people. This is part of their heritage. This is part of their history. This is part of who they are. How come we Muslims are more entitled to Musa and to Ashura than the people who were saved on that day by the prophet that was and the messenger that was sent to them? Well, in In another hadith reported by Al-Bayhaqi and the Daraqutni and in the books of the Sunan, this hadith is authentic. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said a very interesting hadith. He said, نَحْنُ مَعَاشِرَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ إِخْوَةٌ لِعِلَّاتِ أُمَّهَاتُنَا شَتَّى وَدِينُنَا وَاحِدٌ. We, the group of prophets, are brothers for various reasons. Our mothers are different, and our religion is one. It is almost, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the root of where we come, because every human comes out from the same origin, from the same orifice. So every prophet came from a different woman, but their religion is like who they took care of them, who they live for, who they love, is their religion. And Musa alayhi salam is brother of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What ails Musa, ails the Prophet Muhammad. What pleases Musa, pleases us as well. And because we are people of the Tawheed, the correct Tawheed that Musa alayhi salam brought, and the children of Israel have corrupted their texts, and they have changed, altered, and modified, then we are on the true path, and they are on a falsified path. And thus, this is why we have more authority and more ownership to Musa alayhi salam and Ashura than they themselves. Then he, sallallahu alayhi salam, when he got to Al-Madinah, he fasted Ashura, and Ramadan was not yet prescribed. And he commanded the Sahaba to fast. He fasted one day, and they fasted one day at the beginning. It is only towards the end, in year 10, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasted the year 10, the Jews, after he fasted it, the Jews said, you see, Muhammad fasts exactly like us. We fast on the 10th, and he fasts on the 10th. That's because he follows our lead. Muhammad is nothing else but a follower to us. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard that, he said, if I were to live to the next year, I will fast the 9th and the 10th. And then, subhanallah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died that very same year, on the 10th year, in Rabi' al-Thani. Now here, I want to spend a little bit of time as to why do we fast the 9th and the 10th. First of all, the Jews took Ashura as a Eid. And in Islam, as you know, it is haram to fast on a Eid. So, for us Muslims to worship Allah on the day of Ashura, and that's that. We don't take it as a Eid. That the Jews, like the Jews, we fast Ashura. And when we fast Ashura, it no longer holds the status of a Eid. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to fast on the day of Ashura, he took away from us any possibility that one day should someone resemble the Jews and treat Ashura as a celebration day. Let me ask you a question here. The 9th and the 10th. A lot of people ask, can I fast the 10th and 11th? Well, look at it this way, how Islam looks at it this way. If a king asks for a gift to be given on the 10th of Ashura, and then he says, I will allow a day before the 9th or a day after. For the love of Allah, when would you give your gift? On the 10th or on the 9th or the 11th? Well, it turns out that anyone who wants to gain special status with the king will hasten to give his gift or her gift on the 9th. Well, there you go. If the Jews wait until the 10th to show Allah appreciation for the good he did for them, we will go an extra step and show our appreciation one day before you. Isn't that beautiful? Aren't you speaking volumes about yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Well, indeed you are. Fasting the 9th and the 10th shows great dedication, an early appreciation, and a quick submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it also says a lot about you. You give an extra day of your life to appreciate something that Allah has given to you. Of course Allah would give you more. Ibn Abbas mentioned, radiallahu anhuma, mentioned something very interesting. In the meaning of the hadith, he says that I never saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam greatly awaiting the fasting of a day like that of Ashura, which has great rewards. And this is in Al-Bukhari. So here the day of Ashura holds a great element of rewards. But what is the reward that we should exactly expect from Ashura? Well, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, صِيَامُ يَوْمِ عَاشُورَ إِنِّي أَحْتَسِبُ عَلَى اللَّهِ أَيُكَفِّرَ السَّنَةَ الَّتِي قَبْلَهِ Muslim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the fasting of the day of Ashura, I أحتسب, يعني I expect from Allah, and this is true, it happens, that He will forgive the sins of the previous year, and this is in Sahih Muslim. But we need to understand something, my dear brothers and my dear sisters. And this is, again, a lot of people miss the understanding in this context. When any hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if you do this, Allah forgives all your sins, even if they were like the white of the waves of the oceans. What you want to understand from that, my dear brothers and my sisters? Or, for example, when you go to Hajj, you will come back from Hajj like the day you were born, i.e. sinless. What a lot of people misunderstand is the sins here is not every sin that you have committed. What it is the minor sins, the major sins, they require a repentance. They will not be forgiven just like that. What this means is, let's say, you backbit about 10 people last year and you did small, tiny, little fibs here and there and you delayed salat here and there, few like this. When Ashura comes in, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive all minor sins, and just like a sore thumb, all the major sins will be there. So when you fast this Ashura, as you should, on the 11th day of Ashura, you will be exactly as this, totally cleansed from the last year's sins, minor sins, and all your major sins will be there still awaiting a repentance from you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even Hajj doesn't take your major sins. A lot of people don't pay attention to this. Whenever you hear, I repeat, whenever you hear any ahadith or any ayah in the Quran where Allah forgives all the sins, it means the minor ones. The major ones require a tawbah, a repentance with the conditions of the tawbah. In the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that we fast the 9th and the 10th to contradict, to preserve the independence and personality of a Muslim. Today we see here in the West, Muslims are really funny. I see people, they completely shave their hair as the footballers of the Jews and the Christians, as people out there, which is fashion, completely like the Marines, and they leave their beards. And obviously, this is haram. The act of shaving that way, my sisters and my brothers, is haram. And there is a curse when someone shaves their head. Sometimes I see a Muslim who claims to love Allah, and I see their face, subhanAllah, there is not much difference between him and an English person. And I look to myself, how do they allow themselves? How can they face Allah in as-salat with that kind of haircut? My brothers and my sisters, to understand, and Ashura, let me ask you this question. What is it in it for us? Is it like going hungry a whole day and get the previous year's sins forgiven? Is that what it is all about? Well, as it turns out, there is more to Ashura than we think. This is why every year we fast Ashura and we are not changing. Our life is still the same. It's because we actually do not understand the hidden meaning of Ashura. There is a divine message wrapped up in a box called Ashura. And tonight you will get to understand what that divine message is. So what does Ashura and destiny hold for us today? Well, let's go and find out. And I'm gonna go back in history and in time where Ibrahim alayhi salam one day was gifted by Ishmael. Ismail alayhi salam is taken to Mecca by his father. A lot of people think that it's Sarah who got jealous of Hajar and told Ibrahim, get rid of her. And obviously this is a big lie. Ibrahim alayhi salam took Hajar to Mecca by command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim goes back to Palestine and Sarah is after some time given the great news that she is going to be pregnant with Ishaq. And in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives her also the good news that Ishaq is going to have another child, and that's Ya'qub alayhi salam. Ya'qub alayhi salam is who is called Israel, or what we call today Israel, or Israel. Israel is the name of Ya'qub, and it means Abdullah. That's why we have Jibra'il. Il is Allah. And then the Jibra'il, Mika, Isra, and all these are other names, like Abdullah, Abdul Razzaq, and all these, Abdul Ilah, and so on and so forth, Abdul Salam, and so on and so forth. The children of Yaqub alayhi salam, the 12 of them, the boys, and he had girls also, they had different mothers. It just happened that Yusuf alayhi salam and Binyamin had a different mother than the rest of the kids. Yusuf alayhi salam is number 11, and Binyamin is the youngest. But Yusuf alayhi salam was given something extremely, extremely beautiful. He was given half of the beauty. That beauty is half of what Allah gave to our father Adam alayhi salam. Adam was given the full beauty. Half of it was given to Yusuf alayhi salam, and the other half to all of us mankind. Yusuf alayhi salam also was a man that was gifted by Allah tabaraka ta'ala with visions. A vision that Yusuf alayhi salam saw triggered the fear of his father Yaqub alayhi salam. Yusuf saw that 11 constellations and the moon and the sun prostrated to him. Yaqub alayhi salam is a man gifted by Allah with a beautiful gift, knowledge. وَإِنَّهُ لَذُو عِلْمٍ لِمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ. And Yaqub alayhi salam was a man that was given a special knowledge by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Yaqub knew that his son Yusuf alayhi salam had a play in the history of mankind. He didn't know what, but he knew this boy would be one day made very special by Allah. And he knew that Yusuf would be a prophet someday. So Yaqub tells his son, please don't tell your brothers this, because Yaqub knew the brothers weren't very friendly and they were a danger and they hated him. And if Yusuf tells them that he saw this, that's it. This vision, his brothers would kill him. But Yusuf alayhi salam, being a small young teenager, about 13, 14 of age, one day he was playing with his brothers and in a moment forgot what his father said to him. He told his brother what the vision was, and that increased the animosity of his brothers, and they wanted to get rid of him and gain the love of their father and his attention. A long story short, they took him to a dead well and they threw him there, and then they came back, and you know the story. Yusuf alayhi salam ends up in Egypt. Egypt, my dear brothers and my sisters, throughout history is always run by one of the two dynasties, the Hyksos or the Fara'ina, the pharaohs. When Yusuf alayhi salam was taken to Egypt and sold as a slave, the Hyksos were the rulers. The Hyksos are, so to speak, the labor. They were friendly and they were good and cool. And the Fara'ina were the conservatives. They were the horrible people and things like that. Yusuf alayhi salam ends up in the castle of Al-Aziz. Al-Aziz is like the governor of the whole Egypt. Yusuf alayhi salam grew in that castle from the teenagerhood until he were in his 20s. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a beauty that would make any woman go crazy. Women have weaknesses when they come into the company or in presence of a man. Confidence, status, wealth, and all these things, social proofs, they find themselves, a woman would find herself weak at the knees. Yusuf alayhi salam not only had that, but he had a face and a body sculpted that even the most pious woman today would lose her marbles when she saw, or if she saw, Yusuf alayhi salam. So much so that in his time, women thought he was an angel. So much so that when Zuleikha, the wife of the Al-Aziz, the governor, when she heard the people in the city speaking about her, when she wanted to tempt Yusuf to her bedroom, she prepared a dinner for them and she gave them a fruit, and she brought very, very sharp knives and she gave it to them. And then she gave them the fruits when all of them had the fruits in their hands and they started peeling with the knife. She commanded Yusuf to come and walk just in front of them. When they looked at him, they completely forgot what they had in their hands. And instead of peeling the fruit, they cut open their hands. Hey, if you dig a needle into your hand, you go, Bismillah, and you scream. Cutting your hand and you don't even pay attention, it shows you how beautiful Yusuf alayhi salam was. As I said before, Yusuf alayhi salam asked Allah to take him away from him. And when he was given two options, the jail or temptation, he chose the jail. And Allah told him, Yusuf, if you had asked me for something else, I would have given it to you. But you asked for the jail, I'll give you the jail. So my brothers and my sisters, make sure in this Ashura, you remember, don't ask for things that you can't bear. Yusuf alayhi salam spends 10 years in jail. And people saw how pious he was. But he had something that a lot of people didn't have. He had the power of explaining vision, not of the past, but in the future. You see a vision in your dreams, and he will tell you about the future of it. A lot of people took advantage and benefited out of that. One of these people was one servant of the king, somebody who used to serve wine to his king. Yusuf alayhi salam, when he saw a vision, he told him that you will escape and you will go safe, while your friend, who is the bread maker, will perish. Lo and behold, the wine servant escapes jail. Not escapes, but is taken away from jail. Yusuf alayhi salam tells him, recall me, remember me. When you are out there, tell your king what has happened to me and how I am forgotten in jail. The man goes out and completely forgets about Yusuf alayhi salam. And just like a vision took Yusuf away from his father into a well and sold as a slave, the king was given a vision. He saw the cows, very thin, poor, weak cows, 7 of them, eating 7 very healthy and fat cows. And then he saw some wheat heads, and he saw the dream, as in the Quran. The king wanted an explanation to his vision. These professional vision interpreters could not tell him. The man who was in jail with Yusuf remembers the wine server, and he goes, there is a man in jail, and he can tell you that. Let me go back to him. He goes back to Yusuf alayhi salam. And again, a vision gets Yusuf out of jail. Subhanallah. And then, as you know the story, the brothers of Yusuf come to him. And then he sends for his brother. And then he commands the whole family to go to Palestine, bring his father Yaqub, his mother, and the whole tribe of Israel and his children, 11 children, with his wives and the daughters, to come to Egypt. That was the time where the children of Israel came out from Palestine to Egypt. Necessity took the children of Israel from Palestine, and bread and making money, making a better living, having a better future, took them to Egypt. Just like you, my brother. What brought your parents from Pakistan, Afghanistan, from North Africa, from South Africa, from Egypt, from any country? What brought you to England? You will see it's the same reason that brought the children of Israel from Palestine. Necessity, need, better life. So the children, from now on, when I say the children of Israel, I want you to think about yourself, about us, the Muslims here in the West, who are here out of necessity. A small minority came to England or France or Europe or the United States. And now, just like the children of Israel, when they went to Egypt, there were about 200 people that went to Egypt. And when Musa alayhi salam left Egypt, he left it out with 650,000 Jews. From 200 to 650,000 or more.